السلام عليكم، حياكم الله جميعا. Today we're going to talk about CLABSI surveillance and the importance of CLABSI surveillance in our health facility. طبعا هنا نتكلم عن أهمية أو ما هي الديفايس associated modules. CLABSI VE سابقا فاب كاوتي and dialysis event. And our topic today is about CLABSI, bloodstream, centerline associated bloodstream infection. هنا نتكلم على the importance of CLABSI and the importance of preventing CLABSI. We have the impact of CLABSI على the healthcare setting and على the patient. نتكلم على the increase of length of stay 7 days and maybe more. نتكلم على attribution to mortality and morbidity. نتكلم 15 to 18%. نتكلم على cost. نتكلم على $7,000 to $29,000 per episode or per event. This is the impact of CLABSI. That's why we try our best to reduce CLABSI in our healthcare facility. The definition of CLABSI: it's a primary bloodstream infection, laboratory confirmed bloodstream infection that are not secondary to an infection in other body site. It's primary blood not happened in another site of the body. We're gonna talk about the secondary bloodstream infection later. CLABSI: it's laboratory confirmed bloodstream infection with the center line in place for more than 2 days, and the day one, is the day of placement of the device, and the center line or an umbilical catheter was in place on the date of event or the day before. Date of event, زي ما شرحناها سابقاً, it's the first element you use to meet LCP criteria occur within the 7 days infection window period. طبعا لما يكون عندي criteria 2 element or 3 element, first element is the date of event. طبعا نتكلم على center line. It's an intravascular catheter that terminates at or close to the heart or inside or in one of the great vessels, يعني to the heart or the great vessels, which used to, عندنا 3 uses for centerline: infusion, withdrawal of blood, or hemodynamic monitoring. فإذا the line will not use for this 3 purposes, this is not, we will not consider it as a centerline. The following are considered great vessels for purpose of reporting centerline infection and continuing centerline days. As you know, pulmonary artery, femoral, intrajugular veins, subclavian, all of this, it's considered as great vessels for centerline. As you can see, this picture is showing the great vessels, the most common use in adult internal jugular and subclavian, and the most common use in children, the femoral. And as you know, usually in adult we avoid to use femoral because it's had great rate of infection. Type of center lines: we have temporary, a center line that's non-tunneled, and we have permanent, include tunneled catheter and implant catheter, and an umbilical catheter, a center line vascular device inserted through the umbilical artery or vein in neonatal patient. Type of centerline, as we said, non-tunneled catheter. It's traveled directly from the skin entire site to the veins and used for short-term therapy. As we know, non-tunneled is for short-term therapy. Tunneled catheter are travels a distance under the skin from the point of insertion before terminating at or the close to the heart, one of the greatest vessels. But there is example Hickman centerline. This is will help stabilize them to make them useful for long-term therapy. They can have one or more lumens. As you know, we can use single lumen, double lumen, or triple lumen, depending on the needs of the patient. And usually we ask to have as infection control the less lumen for the patient. نتكلم عن implanted port. حاليا it's not used too much. They used to have the peripheral inserted center line. A big line is inserted in large peripheral veins. It's more preferable than the implant port. Here's some slides showing the each type of catheter, what is advantage and disadvantage, and all information about each type of catheter. This is for all your information. If you want to read about it, you can read the different type, tunneled and non-tunneled, and all the type of catheter. Here there is some information about tunneled center line, and here about peripheral inserted center line catheter, the big line. Here the implant port and some information about it. As we said before, devices are not considered as a center line if the device is not used for infusion or withdrawal of blood and hemodynamic. And other that, we will consider it as a center line. There is different type of the lines that are not considered as a center line, like pacemakers, wires, and other lumen device inserted into center blood vessels or the heart are not considered central lines, because if the fluid are not infused and pushed or withdrawn through such device. Here there is some example for device are not considered as a central line. There is different types. It's for your knowledge and to know about it. بالنسبة للcounting center line days, احنا نتكلم if the patient has more than one temporary center line on the given day, this counting only as one center line. نتكلم إذا كان عندي مريض على أكثر من center line فإحنا بنحسبه only one center line day, not calculated as two device, one device for this patient. طيب لما يكون عنده temporary ويكون عنده permanent, we will choose temporary. Why? Because temporary is high risk of getting infection. Usually we choose the high risk. Okay, we count it as one temporary center line day. And an infant has both umbilical catheter or non-umbilical center line, we count an umbilical catheter day only, because it's high risk of infection. هنا نتكلم على transfer rule. If the date of event of collapse is the day of transfer or the discharge or the next day, the infection is attributed to the transferring location. Here's some example. Patient with center line in place transfer from medical ward to CCU after 4 days. In the CCU, with a center line still in place, LCP criteria are met. This attributed to CCU because the date of event was in CCU. Here, second example, the patient with center line in place and transfer from medical ward to the CCU after one day in CCU and with center line still in place, LCP criteria are met. That means they attributed to the medical ward. Now we're going to talk about LCP criteria and how we identify CLABSI in our health facility. As you know, we have LCP1, LCP2, LCP3 for identification of CLABSI. First, we will talk about LCP1. When we say LCP1, then we have one recognized pathogen is enough for us, only one recognized pathogen or more. Okay, but one it's enough. For no need for any another element, because LCP1 for only one element and one culture. For we said one recognized pathogen from one or more blood specimen by culture or non-culture based microbiological testing method. And organism identified from blood is not related to an infection at another site. It will not be secondary to secondary bloodstream infection. But as to summarize it, one LCP1, we need one recognized pathogen, only one or more, and it's not secondary to another site. طيب LCP2 فاحنا نتكلم LCP1 و2 all for any age of patient تمام LCP2 for, as we said two for we need two elements and we need two cultures to confirm it is CLABSI. What is the two elements? Sign symptoms and blood culture. Okay, and the blood culture we need two sign specimen. What is the two? It should be common cell matching, the two culture matching together, and for sure the organism identified from blood is not related to an infection at other site. And the sign symptoms, fever more than 38 and chills or hypotension. The LCP3 it's almost the same in LCP2. The difference is the age of the patient is less than 1 year of age and almost the same criteria. Only the difference is the sign and symptoms, fever or high fever or low fever, apnea and bradycardia. All of this is symptoms, especially for neonatal, and the same all criteria that common cell identify from two or more, and the criteria must occur within the infection window period. نتكلم عن note about LCP criteria. All positive blood specimen regardless of the site from which they were collected or purpose of which they are drawn must be included in CLABSI surveillance. We mean if we take it from central or peripheral, we don't care about from where you take the sample, if it's meeting all criteria as recognized pathogen or two culture matching council, it will be include in CLABSI surveillance. If the patient meet LCP 1 and 2 and 3, then or 1 and 2, then we will report 1. Why? Because 1 is more stronger than 2 because of recognized pathogen. what do you mean by recognize pathogen? It's not coming from contamination, like maybe like common cell are reported. But usually LCP1 is more stronger and more accurate. Here's some notes about criteria 2 and 3. When we have a common cell and two culture, and the first one is the first diagnosis to use to determine the infection window period. طبعا نتكلم هنا على نوتس للكريتيريا 2 و 3 اللي هي common cell, انه لازم يكون عندنا 2 or more blood specimen draw in separated occasion. وش المقصود ب separated occasion؟ نقول انه blood from at least 2 blood draws were collected on the same or consecutive calendar day. ايش معناته same؟ ان اليوم Sunday اخذنا عينة ناخذها نفس اليوم Sunday or Monday maximum. بعد كذا it's not accepted, at least one bottle from each draw. اقلها لازم ناخذ one bottle in each draw. Growing in the same common skin contaminated. طبعا هنا نتكلم على common skin contaminated. هذه list of for your information, and you can look to it. هنا نتكلم على the meeting separate occasion criteria. نتكلم على different lumen. Are we allowed to take from different lumen? Yes. Separate occasion of the same size, such as two draw from single lumen catheter or draw from separate lumen of multiple lumen catheter. In later case, the draw may be just minutes apart. It's okay. We allowed to have different only minutes if then disinfect the site good and draw specimens from each lumen. Yeah, just take time to disinfect and make sure we don't have any problem if you are sure you can disinfect the area before draw the specimens from each lumen. As we said, we are allowed to use the lumen, take culture from lumen and all positive blood culture, centerline or peripheral must be included in diagnostic biopsy. We are not allowing catheter tip. Why? Because usually have high contamination, so we are not allowing to use the catheter tip for sampling. As we said, when there is positive Smith and clinical signs, symptom localized in infection and vascular access site, but no other infection can be found, the infection is considered as primary bloodstream infection. Here example, if the patient with triple lumen centerline has blood draw from each lumen within 15 minutes of each other, each of these consider a separate blood draw. Here we're going to talk about the matching. When we said two microorganisms matching each other, we mean both are matching in genus and species. What do you mean by genus and species? Genus is the first name, species is the second name. We are not caring about resistance. احنا ما نطلع في resistance, احنا نطلع فقط في name of microorganism. طبعا each microorganism عندهم two names, first and second. The most important is written the first. If it's matching, then we can say this is matching, it's matching microorganism. طبعا هذه بعض الاكزامبل للماتشنج او النون ماتشنج. الموضوع مرة سهل. نتكلم على الباسيلس، it's the same genus ف it's LCB 2 or 3. حتى لو اختلف عندنا species فنتكلم على 2. الاكزامبل الثاني اللي هو كوغليز نيجاتيف ستيفيلوكوكاي ولا ستيفيلو ابيديرمتس، all they are the same. هي جزء منها من الكوغليز نيجاتيف، ف we can say matching and LCB 2 or 3. هنا في الاكزامبل الثالث لا تختلف، الستيفيلوكوكس اوريوس هي اصلا ايدنتيفاي اورجانيزم او فهي اتس ال سي بي 1 فوي دونت نيد الكوغليز نيجاتيف ستيفيلوكوكاي. في المثال الرابع سينوباكترز they are the same but all it's identify organism that's LCB1 only when we say common cell that we need to culture to meet the criteria for 2 or 3. The third one the same as Acinobacter, all the same genus and they are identify microorganism فإتس LCB1. طبعا هنا نتكلم على Specimen Collection Consideration، نتكلم على Ideal لازم يكون عندنا Blood Specimen should be obtained from 2 to 4 فتو we can have the matching if we have 2 draw from separate venture site right or left not through vascular catheter. The blood draw should be performed the same time and ناخذها بنفس ال time or over a short period of time within few hours. A blood specimen may consist of single bottle. في البيدياتريك ليش ناخذ single bottle؟ لأنه كمية الدم في البيدياتريك تكون قليلة. ف draw due to volume of blood للpatient. عندنا criteria 1 و 2. May use for patient any age زي ما قلنا أول include this 1 year or less. Criteria 3 فقط less than 1 year. نتكلم على organism not accepted or acceptable for CLABSI. نتكلم على intentional organism as a sole pathogen in primary BSI. نتكلم على السي ديفيسيل والسلمونيلا والشيجيلا، all they are MPI and we're gonna talk about the MPI. When it come alone that mean if it's meeting the criteria of MPI it will be MPI not CLABSI. And if it's come with the pathogen it's identify organism that will be CLABSI LCB1. Here we have some organism associated with fungal pathogen as cause of CLABSI. They are not accepted for CLABSI and rare you're gonna find it in your hospital or in any hospital, but you need to know it for your knowledge. نتكلم على center line removed and reinsert when we start to calculate from again if and after center line removed the patient is without center line for last one full calendar day. يعني بمعنى إذا كان ما كمل one full calendar day gap بين ال first to second center line فاحنا we will continue calculating the days. If it's more than one calendar day then we will stop calculating the first line and we will start to calculate the other one. For here we said the center line days count will start anew if insert a new center line is inserted before a full calendar day. We didn't have full calendar day without center line has passed. The center line day count will be continue. Then that means we will not stop and we will have example after this slide. هنا نتكلم على center line removed in day our April 2 and reinsert in April 3. There is no one full calendar day in between. For this mean we will continue the center line day count, no one day gap. Here's second example for the center line remove in day 5, April 2, and there is one full calendar day gap between the reinsert in day April 4 and April 3, no center line for one calendar day. We mean we'll start the center line day counting from the day 4, and when because of there is one day gap. We're gonna talk about the CLABSI or the secondary BSI and the criteria when we say this is secondary BSI or primary BSI. هنا نتكلم على secondary or some scenario about secondary BSI. عندنا two scenario. The first scenario is the classic one. لما نقول إن عندنا blood specimen must contain matching organism of the site specimen. And collecting in the secondary BSI attribution period. تمام؟ نتكلم إنه ال other specimen أخذت في during the window أو infection window period من اليورين ولا من اللونج. فنتكلم على blood أخذت في ال BSI attribution period اللي هو ال RIT plus the infection window period. And the organism identified from the site infection is used as element to meet the site specified infection criteria. This is the scenario one. نتكلم على second scenario انه كلها blood specimen والother specimen كلها تكون مأخوذة في infection window period. تمام؟ And the blood specimen must be an element of the site-specific criteria and the collecting during the site-specific infection window period and the organism identified in the blood specimen is element that used to meet the site-specific infection period and it's not need to have matching in second scenario. هنا نتكلم على some scenarios most common اللي هي ال SSI with different site deep or superficial. نتكلم ان يكون عندنا positive wound culture وعندنا matching positive blood during ال BSI attribution period اللي هي ال RIT plus ال infection wound period. نتكلم على السوتي في الكاوتي. نتكلم على نفس الشيء positive urine during the infection wound period يكون عندي positive culture وعندي matching positive blood during the BSI attributed period. عندنا نيوم 2 and or 3 or BFAB في VAE criteria. نتكلم على positive respiratory sputum during the infection window period and there is matching positive blood during the BSI attribution period. This is some example and should be clear for you for the secondary BSI. There is an example for how to know the BSI attribution period. For example, if we have an infection or an date of event is day 6 of the hospital, 3 days before and 3 days after it will be the window period, the infection window period, and the RIT will start from the day of event. It will be 14 days plus the window period, it will be 17 days. The other example here, when we said the date of event is day 3 and the BSI will be matching with the RIT. هنا example لل secondary PSI. نقول إنه if there is patient have urine culture with E. coli and in day 7 or in the RIT period they have blood culture with E. coli, it's coming with PSI attribution period, so that means it's secondary to the UTI, but it's reporting as E. coli SUTI and secondary PSI in the same form. We will not report it in two forms. In one form, we report E. coli for urine UTI and secondary PSI. Here another example about if we have urine culture with E. coli and blood culture with E. coli, it will be secondary, and we have another microorganism Staphylococcus aureus from urine culture. Are we going to report two event for urine culture? No, it will be one event. We report it as SUTI. Date of event day 4, organism E. coli and Staphylococcus. In the same form, we report two microorganisms and the E. coli in the blood that will be secondary. راح نتكلم عن الكلابسي analysis, how to calculate rate و SAR and the bundle compliance for centerline. نتكلم عن الكلابسي rate, how to calculate the collapse rate. نقول total collapse event على centerline days during the period اللي انت you calculate for this month or for this year, how much centerline days you have and how many collapse event you have by 1000, and the rate will be for example 2 per 1000 centerline days. The same we'll do for MBI, LCBI rate, we'll have the event and the centerline days by 1000, and we can stratification by location. We will say the rate by this location, ICU-A, ICU-B, ICU-C, medical surgical or medical cardiac or the ward, and by the weight group of neonatal or by the type of catheter, as يعني you can have different certification for the rate. هنا نتكلم على centerline utilization ratio. What do we mean by centerline utilization ratio? Is the percent of using centerline in our department? Is it above national benchmark or below? How we calculate it? We will take the total centerline days during this period. And we'll divide it by the patient days, and we will have this number. It's 0.45. For example, we'll have 45% our use of centerline. We can stratification by location, by weight, by catheter, and we can compare it between the benchmark to know if there is misusing or using too much of the centerline in our department. We will try to discuss it with our doctors, our ICUs doctors, to reduce the utilization ratio of centerline, because if you know if we use centerlines above the benchmark, it will have more collapse rate. We will try our best to reduce our utilization ratio in our department. After we know about collapse definitions and how to calculate collapse rate, we're going to talk about how to prevent from getting collapse event. First, we need to know the collapse bundle, or what is the benefit of bundle. It's a bundle is a structure's way of improving process of care and patient outcome. It's a small and straightforward set of evidence-based practice. Usually, it's 3 to 5 element that when performed have been proven to improve the patient outcome. We'll talk about what is a CLABSI bundle. Benefit of centerline bundle. Why we implement bundle or why we want to reduce our CLABSI rate? First, to implement a bundle of CLABSI to reduce the infection rate. Why? To low rate of complication. 3, to improve patient safety and certification. 4, for cost saving and resourcing utilization. Here we gonna talk about component of centerline bundle. First is the hand hygiene. As we know, it's the most important element to reduce infection rate. So we need to perform hand hygiene, good hand hygiene. When using a maximum barrier precaution, we mean the mask, gown, drape, all of the maximum barrier precaution, and to use chlorhexidine skin antiseptic to reduce the infection, and to obtain a catheter site selection. As we know, we have 3 sites for the adult: subclavian, intrajugular, and femoral. As we know, the subclavian is the lowest CLABSI rate, and intrajugular and the least, and the one we don't prefer to use it, the femoral site. And we talk about the using of ultrasound guide to place the centerline catheter, and the evidence base prove that when we use ultrasound guide, it will reduce CLABSI rate by not puncturing a patient multiple times. Here we're gonna talk about what are the components of centerline maintenance bundle. First, the same hand hygiene and aseptic technique when we are doing maintenance for the centerline. Daily review and assessment of catheter if it's need or not to remove it, because we don't want to catheter to stay long in the patient. And proper dressing choice. We prefer the dressing with chlorhexidine to reduce infection rate, and proper frequency of dressing change. As you know, for the gauze is 2 days, and for the transparent dressing with or without chlorhexidine is every 7 days. And usually there is some malpractice for a proper frequency of changing the dressing for the catheter, and proper replacement of administrative set. And there is guideline for when we remove administrative set, when we use blood, or when for the patient with chemotherapy, when or the regular patient. In Ministry of Health, we work on a CLABSI tool with many documents for CLABSI to reduce it. We will talk about it one by one. Here is the 7 CLABSI prevention tool. 1 authorization letter. That means there is 1 guy or 1 nurse and 1 person he's authorized to stop any insertion or maintenance if there is a broken little aseptic technique. And second, we need to have list of eligible ICU doctors to who can insert the centerline, and it's approved from the head of ICU and the head of medical director in the hospital. We need to have competency assessment for the ICU physician and the ICU nurse for the insertion and maintenance. And we need to have adherence monitoring for a form to monitor the staff compliance to centerline insertion. That means we need to supervise 1 insertion, 1 maintenance randomly, and monitor the insertion and maintenance. auditing to monitor the compliance to centerline maintenance practice, and about the centerline supplies, we need to have and monitor the supply. We need to make sure that all the time is available to the physician and nurse. And the education and training for all the ICU staff and documented to make sure they are well trained about the insertion and maintenance of centerline. If you need to know more about CLABSI and CLABSI Prevention Toolkit, you can visit our gdibc.sa and you choose Department HAI Surveillance, and there is a file for CLABSI and there one page for CLABSI Prevention Strategy. You can find everything, and there is link for to know the common commensal list to identify a pathogen, if it's common commensal or recognized pathogen. You can find it in our website, the link, or you can search about it in Google. And thank you so much. Thank you for listening to our lecture, and I hope you understand all the points about CLABSI identification and how to do a CLABSI analysis and how to prevent CLABSI. And thank you so much again for your listening.